the title of today is Digital Revolution and Evolution in Science, and I like to be a contrarian, so what I do is just the reverse, bringing science into the next digital revolution. And I'm also particularly happy because this session here is about from science fiction to reality, and actually I am going to tell you about something which not just when I was, an egg in the womb of my mom, but still when I was teaching quantum information to my students 10 years ago, when I started doing this in Ulm, I told them, look, yes, this is fun. You know, maybe one day it can become reality, but you know, it's mostly science fiction. We can have fun with it. And I will show you pictures of these things being for real. And so this is sort of really fitting to the current context. So what I would like to start is by telling you a story from when I was a young postdoc. So it was my second week in Innsbruck, in Austria. I'm a theorist, so we are on the fourth floor, and then, of course, you go to the ground floor, and there they are experimentalists in the labs, in the cellar, and so on. So I take my bike, and I try to bike home. And in comes a black limousine, and out comes the Dalai Lama. And His Holiness came to Innsbruck to do something which you, and also even my children, have studied in school that is impossible. We have been all taught that it is impossible to see a single atom with your eye. So His Holiness learned that in the lab of my colleague Rainer Blatt in Innsbruck was possible already then to do what now is routine in many labs around the world, and which is the foundation of the second quantum revolution, which I'm going to speak about, which is you have a little can of metal in vacuum, and there is some field there. And this field traps a single atom. And between the atom and your eye, there are only lenses, like between my eye now and you, like only lenses, like a little microscope. You wait a little bit in darkness, and then you put your eye to the eyepiece, and then you see it there, a single beryllium atom, little tiny, glowing, greenish, down there, a bit lonely, but it is there, and you can control it. And this is the foundation of the second quantum revolution, controlling individual quanta, something that the founding fathers of quantum mechanics thought was more unlikely, to quote Schrödinger, than raising a pterodactyl in a zoo. Okay, and nowadays we do it every day. So let me show you a few examples of that. Well, the first example is not really the second quantum revolution, it's the first one. You have it in your pockets. Without mastering the laws of quantum mechanics, it would be completely impossible to have lasers, computers, projectors, cell phones, anything in our digital society. We can process information with electronics only because we can control the behavior of quantum mechanical systems, because we know how they work. And this is still at the level, a very rough level. So for every bit in our digital society, for every zero and one, we have hundreds and thousands of electrons flowing in a circuit, of photons in an optical fiber, which is driving, you know, you wouldn't have Facebook, Google. Maybe that would not be so bad if you didn't have Facebook and Twitter. I don't know. But still, it's certainly something which is quite widespread. And this is based on quantum mechanics, because you cannot transmit data unless you pump this through laser pulses in optical fibers. And so a lot of applications, also in medical, many of the things that we have seen today are made possible by mastering the laws of quantum mechanics. But still, as I said, this is bulk effects. For every unit of information, many, many quantum objects. Now, what happens? Well, the size of these things is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. When I was young, you got every other year, you would have a Windows version which had more fancy animations in it, because they needed to sell the corresponding PC, which would have twice as much computing power, and they needed to fill it, okay, in order to sell it to you. And the fact is that, you know, according to Moore's law, the power of computers, so the size of the number of elements which you can cram into a chip, would double every year and a half by constant price. This is no longer happening. You know, the Pentium, which was there when I was young, and every year, you know, another gigahertz. Now, this is no longer happening. You buy your computers, and then the clock rate stays constant. So we are already at a stage in which we cannot make these things much, much smaller. Or if we make them smaller, they get soon to a size in which, as I said before, every bit is one atom, is one quantum element. So what can we do with that? Well, here is His Holiness. I cannot really read to you what he wrote on the guest book of Professor Blatt, but the point is that what he saw there, and this is the fascinating for me, because this is really something almost philosophical. You make possible something which you thought was a dream, was only a thought experiment. In English, in Italian, in every language, we use the German word Gedankenexperiment. Yeah? In Italian, for instance, in the lecture, the professor will say, e adesso facciamo un Gedankenexperiment. Yeah? So this is what was thought to be completely only possible in thought, and now it is possible in reality. And this is almost philosophical, but it is a basis of real applications, of real things that you can sell. As Faraday once said to the Chancellor of the Exchequer, who was not really convinced by the applicability of electricity, he said, but sir, one day you might be able to tax it. And so this is what is happening with quanta nowadays. So what you have here, so I stole this slide from Bill Phillips, Nobel laureate 97, and well, this is a metaphor showing, you know, the concept of superposition entanglement, the basic ideas of quantum mechanics. So you have a picture there, this cube. Okay, if you look at it, the one on the left, you can see it either looking upwards or looking downwards, but never this both at the same time. But the object is both at the same time, but when you observe it, it will collapse into one or the other. More interestingly, if you have two of such objects, you know, the row below, you are never going to be able to see them, one upwards and one downwards. Try it. You will either see both of them upwards or both of them downwards. In quantum terms, you can create states of electrons or photons which are like that, and they preserve this property even if we move them very far apart. So what happens is that you can create devices that exploit this, for instance, for secure communication. And this is a picture of a satellite. This was science fiction when Anton Zeilinger realized teleportation in 97 in Vienna, Austria. And he went to the European Space Agency and he said, let's do this for real because it has a good application. And the European Space Agency half laughed and half slept on it. And Anton had a student whose name was Janwei Pan. He was not exactly from Tirol, as you can imagine. He went back to his home country. He got from President Xi a couple of billions. And I'm going to show you what he did with that. He did this thing for real. So fortunately, also in the field of quantum communication, I have 4 minutes and a half and 4 slides for the 4 application areas of this field. And one is quantum communication. Now I have individual photons, which I can teleport, I can entangle, and so on. The idea is those are quanta. You cannot split them in half. If you send your bits with many photons, comes the NSA. We all know that. They take a few of those photons per bit, and they can read whatever we are saying. We know that. The Snowden affairs, for instance. Now, if it is a quantum, you cannot split in half. It's a quantum. You cannot cut it. Okay, so if they get it, we notice it. And so when it arrives, once it's there, we know for sure and forever that no one has intercepted it. And you can buy devices. The market-leading, world-leading company is in Geneva. It's a spin-off of a European Commission project, which is called ID Quantique. And they sell these things. You can buy them. Banks and governments buy them and deploy them. And one of the ideas with this new flagship initiative is to deploy a pan-European quantum secure network with us. And so this is relevant for all of us who want their data to remain secure. And this is a picture of a video conference which was made between Anton Zeilinger and his colleague from Beijing, the president of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, last year. They did it via satellite. So the Chinese realized this experiment, and now they are using it as a communication channel on global scale. Now, quantum computers. That's another instance where you use individual quantum systems. Now, you can put this in these entangled strange states, and this means you can have many, many states that you process at the same time. You can solve problems with enormous speed for applications such as in artificial intelligence, and we have seen some of that. And this is something which, again, when I taught my students 10 years ago, I said, oh, maybe, well, you know, but now we can have some fun as physicists like that. And nowadays we have Google, IBM, Intel, Microsoft, who are investing each $100 million every year in this, which is also one of the arguments which convinced the European Commission that we should really move on, and also our federal government, which announced a few weeks ago a program for $650 million in quantum technologies in this legislature. Here another example, quantum simulation. This is actually a picture which is very dear to me because this is taken from a paper from some colleagues from the Max Planck Institute in Garching from 2012, and I showed this picture to a couple vice presidents of the European Commission. And he asked questions, something you wouldn't expect from politicians, about something taken from a science paper. And why is that? Because this shows you have heard, probably, that you know quantum computers do not exist yet. You know, there is this idea of quantum supremacy, or as we call it, rather in Germany here, quantum advantage, because the word supremacy sends some shivers down our spine in this continent, but not in the US. Anyway, so you have heard that it is not yet there. Not true. For a quantum simulator, a device with many of these little atoms in an array, which can be controlled precisely to mimic the properties of some material, you can check, calculate the properties of this material with a black line. This is a supercomputer in Jülich. This was done a few years ago. And then the quantum simulator calculates the blue dots and reproduces those data and goes a little bit on. And we have many, many more instances of this which are relevant for the development of new materials, for calculating properties of chemicals, which have prospects in application for development of drugs, fertilizers, and other types of chemicals and materials. And the last one, so since we had some wonderful talks about brain, of course, it was said we don't want to do something which you know, can be done, only done in one place in the world, so we have this a little bit fuzzy images. But with quantum technologies, we can develop methods to monitor single neurons in real time. And actually, again, this sounds like science fiction, but Bosch, the company Bosch, has a pilot program in the German Federal Program for Quantum Technologies, which is going towards building a helmet equipped with those quantum sensors, which are supposed to then be an interface between your brain and a machine, such that I can put this here, and I can think, please advance the slide, and the thing will advance a slide. And of course, there are many more applications in terms of diagnostics and in terms also of understanding brain function, as we have seen before. So, well, there is a lot of activity in the last 7 seconds from China, from the US. I already talked about that. There is a very large investment from many countries. So we put together a consortium of 32 funding agencies from 28 European member states, and it worked. So we have the first projects. We announced the first projects of this flagship last week with a kickoff meeting in Vienna, and I am at 0 seconds. So I can just tell you that our dream is to create a quantum web, so bringing all of these things together to revolutionize what nowadays is the internet. And then the last thing I want to say is that my biggest victory, my biggest personal success in this male-dominated field, shamefully male-dominated field, which is quantum physics, is I convinced, or maybe not, but I'm coordinating, so I could decide, my colleagues to have a pink logo. And so with this, I would like to close my speech. Thank you very much.